with our usual time recap about the past lecture. And what did we learn? Well, we start to investigate the transformation, the frame transformation between an observer and another frame which is moving inertially, meaning with a constant velocity, with respect to the observer. And we end up by imposing the condition for which the velocity of light is the same for every observer. Okay? Every observer observes the speed of light to be the same. And we've seen that we imposed as a condition this very simple expression in which we have this constraint that describes how photons are moving. We have an equal to zero, and this, with the same speed of light, must be respected also for an observer in another frame. Okay? With that, we find out what is the transformation that obeys this constraint. Not any transformation, a linear transformation that obeys these constraints. And I said that we wanted linear because we want to preserve homogeneity. If you are an observer and if you see an homogeneous an object which has properties homogeneously distributed, I am in another frame moving with a constant speed of light, with a constant velocity with respect to that object, I still see it homogeneous. Or I'm moving together with that object, I see it homogeneous. Linear transformations are the ones that preserve homogeneity. Okay? We are going to see that in a bit later. And we found out that the transformations that then keeps the velocity of light the same for all frames, let's call it F, S, the frames S, are the Lorentz transformations. For which I gave you the expression. Then we realized the fact that yes, this is nice. We get all physical concepts, but it's a little bit, if we want to do some more complex computations and we want to dig more into the physical meaning of things that are related to this sort of transformations, we need a little bit more sophisticated mathematics, because so far we used plus, minus, and a division. Well, there is also an equal. Okay, that's stuff that you do in high school. But we can use vector spaces, we can use metric vector spaces, there are groups, there are all a mathematical structure that can be used to have a better handling of this concept and get, as I said, a better understanding of everything. Okay? And therefore, we described events in terms of time. This transformation, space and times, are kind of entangled. Therefore, we defined our four interval as CT, X, Y, and Z, that then we conveniently re-expressed as an X0, X1, X2, and X3. Right? Components that I stress the fact that they are the indices on the upper part, okay? Because we have seen the difference between these sort of vectors written, these sort of vectors written with the indexes up and the index down. And they have a different physical meaning because in between there is the metric, as we have seen, okay? So that's the concept. And we have seen how it is a simple consideration about transformation in between frames actually has a physical meaning, because we have seen redshift, that we have a relativistic redshift that can happen if an object is moving your direction or even orthogonal, because the time is transforming. And frequencies related to redshift, this case has 1 over time, the units of 1 over time. Time changes, therefore also the shifts in this direction orthogonal to the line of sight gives you a redshift. We've seen time dilation, length contraction, and then what else? What have we seen? Aberration of light, transformation of angles, relativistic beaming, all of that is coming from these simple considerations. So you see just frame transformation, a lot of physics that is taking place. Okay? Good. Now we can continue and investigate a little bit the Lorentz transformation, and we are starting to be a little bit more formal. Okay? Here I gave you the high school approach. Now we are starting, I also introduced the metric, nu, no, which is a, which we can see it as a bilinear mapping, swallowing two vectors, giving us a scalar, which is invariant, is always the same. I already went through that, I will not do it again. That characterizes, basically, the coefficients that we see here. It is minus one, and it is one for the three components, or for the three space components. Okay? Again, it's minus 1, 1, 1, 1, so it is diagonal matrix, because we are using a Cartesian frame. If we are not using a Cartesian frame, I gave you an example. We still have nu, which is the Minkowski metric, but the coefficients are different. The mathematical object is the same, the coefficients are expressed with respect to a different basis. Okay? The key point, and here is a connection with general relativity, is that if you see a matrix that looks non-diagonal, okay, and you might see, oh, is this Minkowski? I don't know. You can then change your frame, you change the basis with respect to compute the coefficients, and you might find out that is minus 1, 1, 1, 1, and all zeros. Okay? Then you can ask ourselves, is this true in every position? Then, if this is the case for every position in your space-time simultaneously, then you know that you are living in a Minkowski space. You are living in a flat space. You know that there is no gravity. There is not a space-time distortion, the metric is flat, and is like this in all locations simultaneously. So you make one transformation, and it fixes the metric all over the places. Okay? If you have gravity, this cannot happen. You can, given a location, fix your metric such that it is in Minkowski, and you know that you can. Think of the bottle that we have seen. We are the water inside the bottle. The bottle is free-falling. What is perceiving the water inside the bottle? A Minkowski metric. So locally, in the location of running with a free-falling object, we have a Minkowski metric. We don't perceive any gravity. So if I make, I can make a transformation, which is a frame, x and y, which is moving with the bottle. Okay, in this frame, I don't see gravity. You are elsewhere, you see this acceleration, you perceive gravity. Your metric is not Minkowski. So locally, you can make it Minkowski, but not everywhere with one single transformation. Okay? So that's a key concept, so it's a, you know, fast forward to see, to make your connection to special relativity such that it will be easier later on to generalize the concepts. Now, why do we want a linear transformation, and I spoke about homogeneity? Well, let's take points, just to characterize our space-time, and they all have the same separation, one with each other. Which kind of transformation can provide that? Well, a rotation, because we are just, you know, changing how we are looking at something like this. Or we can also make a transformation that looks like that. You see, it is not anymore squared. It's like I have a box, and I squeeze it like that. Okay? I kind of push it in this direction. What happens? That these lengths between each individual point are not going to change, because if I tilt the box in this way, if I kind of squeeze it, and I shear it, the length of the box are not changing. They're just shifting one with respect to each other. Okay? this is a linear transformation. So you see that we do not only have this sort of rotations, but we can also tilt the axis like that. Okay? That's different, and we don't want transformations that looks like that. Because this is not homogeneous. The properties here or here are the same all over the places. Here they're not anymore. You see, you lose homogeneity. Therefore, we need a linear transformation. So let's see how is this possible. Well, we've seen it, that we can write it like this. X mu prime is equal to the matrix performing the transformation of our frame, mu prime, you see, we have this mu prime. Then we have a dummy index that I can call nu, that is goes in combination with this other dummy index up here. You see, here we have a repeated indices up and down, and this implies a summatory over the coefficients of our matrix. You have the exercises to play with that. Plus, I could also apply some shift, okay? I can shift my frame wherever I want. This is kind of irrelevant because it doesn't carry much information. You can always shift your frame such that you have A equal to zero. Okay? You just shift the frame. Then, as I said, this linear transformation, you see that are keeping the separation between points constant, invariant. Okay? It means that the scalar product, U, and then another vector, in general, v, is going to be conserved, u prime and v prime. It's always the same. And this automatically connect is equivalent to say that we want our metric to be the same in all frames. This is not the metric itself, the coefficients change. But the metric itself is the same. The object is the same. So if we get nu, it's going to be lambda t, nu, lambda. That's the transformation of the metric. And you see that there is no change in the metric. It goes up there, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1. Right? On the two sides, you have the very same metric. How do we see it in a more formal way? So let me write it, spell it in word, conserved, so the scalar product, or we have the same metric for every frame. The two things are equivalent. So let's see. Well, we have, for example, let's give a look at our scalar product with a vector, with the dx vector with respect to itself, such that we have the norm squared, right? We just have we have a relationship with the norm. And that's equal, if I write it in a matrix form, as I did in the past lecture, this looks like that. That's a metric, and then we have the x. This expression is just that this is in Cartesian form, where we are expressing a Cartesian frame. This is in a frameless matrix form. And this guy, if we are looking at the first expression, we see that is equal to the coordinate that might be changed. So we have the prime, the metric, and then the x prime as well. Then what we can do? Well, this is the vector transform with a Lorentz transformation, because these are the transformations that we are using. I can just express it in terms of the transformation. Therefore, I'm going to have the transformation, and then the x, and then we have the transformation. The metric that I'm not touching, I'm only working on those guys, and then we have the transformation of this vector. Right? This is the x prime, and this is the X prime. So the X transpose prime and the X prime. I apply the transformation, I go to the prime frame. But how can this be equal to that? Well, that's equal to that whenever we have whenever we have this expression holding. Okay? This must be equal to that. You see? The x, and this guy must be that. Whenever we apply a Lorentz transformation, the metric is the metric. Okay? Good. Let's see now how these sort of transformations are, these sort of, you know, these shifts and this kind of shearing, this sort of tilting of the axis from, you know, orthogonal axis, we get something which is like that. How is this related to invariant, Lorentz invariant quantities? Okay, so let's see. Well, let's start with something that you are formal with. So let's try with rotations. Just a rotation, and we know that in 3D, you know, in 2D, just for simplicity, let's take a two-dimensional case, we have our axis, x and y, and I apply a rotation. What's going to happen? Well, that will become something like that. We have our x prime, and we have our y prime. Let's take now a position that is, in our two-dimensional space, which is identified by these two coordinates, on x and x prime. Of course, on x prime and on x and y, and the coefficients are going to be different, you see, on x prime and y prime. That's because of the rotation. Nice. Well, what is the separation between this point and the center? If I set the coordinates to be 0 for this position, then this is going to be just R. And R is the same for the white frame and for the orange frame. Because from here to here, nothing happened. The guy is here, we are just changing the axis around it. We are applying a rotation. And what do we have then? Well, we have that R squared is equal to x squared plus y squared. If we want to relate the coordinates, so if we want to express R with respect to these coordinates. Okay? Writing it with the indices as a sum material as we did. Here we have a Minkowski, we have a Euclidean space that in Cartesian frame, as I draw it here, is just 1, 1, 1, and all the rest is 0. So it's just a diagonal, it's an identity matrix that I can write it like this. So this guy has all elements equal to 0 except those on the diagonal that are equal to 1. And then again, we have our usual repeated index to express this summatory. Okay? I can as well re-express this guy in polar coordinates and use the trigonometric relationship between the axis x and y and the angle alpha with respect to the x-axis. Therefore, what we have, the x-axis is r cosinus of alpha squared, that's this guy, and then we have the relationship with the sinus. We can collect R. And you know that this guy is equal to 0. You can rotate the axis also to another angle. It doesn't matter. You change the axis, whatever is the alpha. You see, this guy is equal to 1 for every alpha. Okay, well, let's make it like this, sorry. And also, this is the cosinus. If I am working here, I have another angle, which is going to be alpha prime. But since alpha is completely arbitrary, R is always the same. And this gives us our invariance. Okay? If we are now looking at, and in this case, mind that this guy is always larger or equal than zero. We are in a standard Euclidean space. No problem with that. We can then generalize this concept, or we can use a different transformation. We can work with a different group of rotations that represents the Lorentz group, and therefore the Lorentz transformations. And likewise, instead of expressing everything in terms of alpha, so this rotation, we are going to use another parameter, which we call rapidity. Rapidity parameter, which is a substitution of the velocity. Okay, so if you have the Lorentz transformation, you have seen that how the things transform depends on the velocity of the moving frame, velocity v. We can have re-express everything, so this is sort of in Cartesian components. If we want to express everything in sort of these rotations, then we introduce this thing here, which is called the rapidity parameter. Okay, we are sort of moving from the velocity to that parameter as we are expressing the transformation with respect to this sort of rotation. Okay? Good. If we do that, we need to find, actually it happens that this rotation is now performed not with respect to cosinus and sinus, but it happens with respect to hyperbolic functions. So these are rotations with respect to an hyperbola. So it's trigonometry based on an hyperbola. Okay, you know from analysis one, the sinus hyperbolicus and the cosinus hyperbolicus. And we can see that we can write the cosinus hyperbolicus of our rapidity function. This is the substitution of the cosinus of alpha that we have before. And we can link it to the gamma factor. And you can say, why are you doing that? Well, now I'm just playing with numbers. Okay, I'm just trying out. And I can do that. It kind of makes sense because gamma goes from 1 to infinity as the cosinus is hyperbolicus with respect to the rapidity parameter, with respect to its argument. Goes from 1 to infinity. So, yeah, it makes sense. At least the mathematics holds. Then I can express the sinus hyperbolicus of my rapidity parameter, and I impose it to be equal to beta gamma. And again, this respects the ranges of the sinus hyperbolicus, because this guy can be positive or negative, depends where in which direction I'm moving, and it goes from minus infinity to infinity. Now, what are the properties of the cosinus and of this hyperbolic cosinus and sinus? Well, the cosinus hyperbolics of this guy minus the sinus hyperbolic square of psi are equal to what? To 1. Do you see the analogy? We are going in that direction. Okay? Enter is a minus, which is nice because what we have in our Minkowski space? We have a minus for the time and plus for the space. And now the rotation is a rotation of the axis. So I am rotating the axis, but if I go from x to ct, now this is the b-dimensional space in which a slice in the four-dimensional space containing the plane x and time. Okay, so this would be x0, writing it as a four vector, sorry. This would be x0, and this would be x1. Okay, if we want to respect the coefficients. So how does the rotation goes? Well, we have the rotation of the x coordinate. Let me use another color. And we are going to x prime. Then we have the rotation of the time. That is not going this way, is going toward x. What happened to the diagonal? It's untouched. The diagonal is the diagonal regardless the transformation, regardless the application of the Lorentz transformation. Okay? So we are not doing like this, we are doing like that. Okay? That's what the Lorentz transformations are doing. And you see that the axis is untouched. So the line along which the photons are traveling, speed of light, is untouched. A photon is the photon and lives along the same diagonal. Okay? Then what we can notice? Well, let's take, for example, a point which is sitting here. So you see that in the X frame, it is a vector that contains non-zero components in space and in time, but I can find out a Lorentz transformation such that it's only a time variable. You see, if I'm moving only along the time component, there is no space. If I have two different intervals, they are moving only along time in this frame, and this is a time event. Time event time like actually, because I can find a Lorentz transformation, I find the right rapidity parameter such that the axis is going to touch it and is only a time event. And in this case, the S square for such an event is smaller than zero. We have, of course, null event, where the S square is equal to zero, and that's the case for all frames. A photon is a photon, is going along the diagonal. Then we can have a space-like event, or space-like points, if I make the transformation such that this point that is, which has component non-zero for space and non-zero component for time in this frame, I can find a rotation such that this is only a space-like. It has only a space component. They are called space-like event, and in this case, the S square is larger than zero. Just a little bit of terminology, okay? Now, let's see for the length. Let's take now this, what was R before, just for to distinguish it, let's call it S, which is related to the four interval. And what do we have? Well, we have S square, because I'm starting from zero to that coordinate. We have minus the x0 squared plus the x1 squared. I'm in a 2D space, therefore I'm neglecting the x and z components, okay? In 2D, that's what we have, and that's the very first thing that I wrote up there. Again, I can express it in the very same way, the mu, the nu. Now I'm using Greek indices to express the fact that I'm working in my Minkowski space, and as well we are going to have the x mu, the x, no, repeated indices. If now I'm going to use this representation, and I'm expressing that the x with respect to the respective cosinus and sinus hyperbolicus, what I get is minus which is coming from the metric, that the first element in Cartesian frame is equal to minus 1. Then we have S, then we have the sinus hyperbolicus of the rapidity parameter squared plus S times the cosinus hyperbolicus of the rapidity parameters to the power of 2. Now we do exactly the same exercise that we did before, and I will put them here, one next to each other. We have that. That's a minus, yes, so there is the minus here. Yes, minus here, and plus cosinus hyperbolicus, squared. Okay, this minus is here. And what is this equal to? Cosinus hyperbolicus squared minus sinus hyperbolicus squared. That's equal to 1. You see, our four interval is conserved, is Lorentz invariant. And if I want to write now the Lorentz the metric, you see that I can do it because it's appearing here. See? Ct prime and then x prime, so this would be my vector transformed, is equal to what? The matrix expressing the Lorentz transformation, the bilinear mapping I was mentioning. And we have the cosinus hyperbolic of psi, sinus hyperbolicus of psi, sinus hyperbolicus of psi, cosinus hyperbolicus of psi. Multiplied the vector in the non-primed frame. So if I perform this matrix multiplication, you get the transformed components of your vector. Okay? And you see, this is still the Minkowski, this is still the Lorentz transformation, now expressed in terms of the rapidity parameter. As I gave you this expression in Cartesian coordinates, this would have been the Lorentz transformation with respect to the velocity of the moving frame. Okay? Now, this was a little bit playing with mathematics, and I kept it light in this way because my focus here was to show you how the rotation is playing, the axis is taking place with the Lorentz transformations, and I just gave you this expression with the sinus hyperbolicus, cosinus hyperbolicus, and we end up by finding out that it is actually expressing the very same transformation that we had in Cartesian coordinates. Okay? If you want, I was just playing around with sinus and cosinus. I was just trying out. Let's see what happens. And wow, it worked. Okay? The thing, there is a way deeper meaning with respect to what I've shown you. And with that, we need a little bit of group theory that you're all familiar, because this is something that you should have seen during the first year in linear algebra. Lorentz group. I've seen terror in your eyes in this moment, but don't worry, it's something super simple, and I'm sure that you will remember what this stuff is all about. Well, let's see, I remind you what is a group. A group is just a collection of elements. Let's call them G. So that these are the elements, these are the ith elements belonging to a group. Can also be discrete, can be continuous, or we are going to see. It doesn't matter. It's a collection of groups, of objects. Objects that must obey some rule that relates one to the other. And therefore, a group contains a connection between elements. And if you want, is as a mathematical object, is a collection of elements equipped with a relationship between the elements. Okay? So this connection is wild, the relationship between groups would be wild. Well, no, because otherwise group could be anything. Okay? Instead, our connection must satisfy this relationship. So if we have one element of the group and another element of the group, and there is an operation that is coupling them, for example, a matrix multiplication, if you're thinking about the Lorentz transformations. But anyway, if we have a relationship between the two, we end up with something that still belongs to the group. So if A, B belong to our group, let's call it now like this, then also C belongs to the group. If I have I can do a rotation, and I can do another rotation. The total rotation is still a rotation. You understand? That's simple. There is nothing more complicated than that. Then it has to obey activity. So if we have one element of the group and operates together with the other one, and we have a third one, then as well we can have, A, B, and C. And again, this must be true for every A, B, and C, so for every element of the group G. Okay, so associative, the operation must be associative. Then we must have the identity, meaning that if we have an element E that is applied to an element A, then this guy must be equal to AE, so I can flip them, and this must be the same, very same element A. So I'm applying an element to this guy, and nothing has happened. And the way around, I'm applying A to that guy, and nothing is happened. So we must have the identity. So it must exist, the identity element. Think of the Lorentz transformations, so the operation between them is a matrix multiplication. And what is the element in matrix multiplication that is not changing the matrix? The identity matrix, which is 1, 1, 1, 1. If I apply that to whatever Lorentz transformation you want, you still get the very same transformation. Okay? Then we must have also the inverse. Because if I have an element A and another element B of my group, and as well I can have, element to group A, I must obtain the identity. And if I have B and I apply it to the element A, I still must have the identity. It means that A is the inverse of B, and B is the inverse of A. We need the inverse of the elements of the group. That's it. What is a group? Is a collection of stuff, and stuff can be anything, can be abstract as you want, which are related with some sort of operation satisfying these conditions. Well, actually, satisfying these conditions, and the group must contain the inverse, and it's possible to have the identity element. Okay, that's it. There's nothing more complicated than that. Then what else? If this is an additional feature that is not true for every group, but for some group, you might have that AB, connection of B, is equal to B, connection of A. You can flip the operation, and this is called activity. You can commute the position. And in this case, you speak about an abelian group. Okay? Yes? I'm not sure I understood. Yeah, the relationship is there, yeah. And, you know, yes, and that minus depends, again, just a caution of, just be cautious. Also, the position of that minus, yes, is related to that. We must have a minus. Without the minus, it doesn't work. Because otherwise, the last expression where there is the big one underneath wouldn't work. So we must have a minus. And there is our choice for the signature. Okay, remember that I told you about the signature. If we go to the first expression, I could multiply both sides by minus one. And I would obtain plus for the t, which would be a plus for the sinus hyperbolicus, and a minus for the others. So the key point is that you must have a minus there. Then you can choose the signature. And yes, there is a relationship between time, in this case, well, also with the other signature, and the sinus hyperbolicus. Okay? Good. So we have some group which have this additional feature, and they are called additive. It's called an abelian group. Then we have also some other groups, which are called the Lie groups. Lie was a guy, was a person, or is a person, I don't know if he's still alive. Anyway, so we have the Lie groups, and this is a collection of elements. So you see, it's a collection of stuff, so it might be a group. That must satisfy all of these conditions, otherwise it wouldn't be a group. Which element now are expressed, are not discrete, but they are continuous with respect to a set of parameters. Okay? So it's called parameters 1, parameters 2, and whatever, parameters n. Okay? So these are a collection of elements that vary continuously. You are not making jumps, okay? You don't have like rotations that is this one or this one, Gesundheit. But you have nothing in between, okay? You have all possible variation in a continuous way. Plus, you must have differentiability. All steps from one to another must be differentiable. What does it mean? In practice, it just means that you don't have discontinuities. If I am moving alpha 1, for example, infinitesimally to another values of alpha, then the transformation cannot make a super jump. You don't have like a discontinuity. If I'm changing the rapidity parameter, I'm not making a rotation from parameter 0 point, from parameter 1, let's say, to parameter 1.0000001, so basically 1, and I end up with that. Okay? I cannot do that. It must be a continuous transition between one element and the other. And guess what? Lorentz transformation are a Lie group. Are a Lie group because I can perform all possible rotations that I want. Okay? But is not abelian. Because if I am applying a transformation with different coordinates, so it's abelian if I would only apply rotations in the same direction, but this element belongs to the Lorentz group, and this element as well belongs to the Lorentz group. So I'm rotating in the x-axis and in the y-axis, they both belong to the Lorentz group. But if I make a rotation with respect to an axis, or first with respect to the other axis, I end up with a different configuration. You cannot flip the rotation. The order is important. Okay, so it's not a Abelian. Now, how can we write the Lorentz group? Well, this is the collection of our Lorentz transformations. And if I write it like this, I just see, I'm just writing, it's a collection of elements. What is the characterization of this group? Well, we haven't done it, we didn't give any characterization. So what we say, this is a collection of elements that are matrices, can be expressed with respect to a matrix. Matrices that must be 4x4, and the elements of the matrix must be real numbers. Okay? Now, from something super abstract, I'm making it more concrete. I'm using the mathematical group theory structure, and I'm applying to our case. Is this enough? No, because there is a constraint, so these are matrices, so the elements must be matrices 4x4 with elements that are real, such that, this means such that, if I have the scalar product between two vectors, this must be the same in if I apply the transformation to those vectors. This is our U prime, this is our V prime. And this must be true for every element, for every vector U and V that belongs to the Minkowski space. Okay? So you see, this is the constraint that give us the invariance of the four vector, or the four intervals, sorry. Okay? And which kind of group is our guy? Well, if I want to write this one in a slightly shorter way, is a special orthogonal group with three components referring to the space, one component referring to time, and the element of our group are real numbers. Orthogonal means that that's equal to the identity in four dimensions, so 1, 1, 1, 1, and all the rest 0. And you can check that this holds. You just have the expression there, or in Cartesian coordinate, you will see that this is true. And this is special, not because it's cool. Well, actually, it is cool because as for all what we have seen, but because the determinant of the of any of the transformations is equal to 1. And this is characterizes the invariance of our scalar product. How many parameters do we have? Well, we have four translations. Because I can shift my reference in x, y, z, and in time. So it's a rigid shift of my frame. And then we have six boosts. Which are associated to three angular rotations. So this is a space rotation and three boosts. So these guys refer to three-dimensional rotations, so how I, in the three-dimensional space of this room, rotate my frame, and three that refers to the transformation between time and the x, time and z, time and y. Okay? The mixture between time and space. All of it sum up to 10 parameters. Groups that contain 10 parameters are called Poincaré groups. Okay? Good. Before the break, and before I wipe out everything here, let's make a little summary. And what we have seen? Well, I just wrote on top there where we started with. We are imposing the speed of light to be the same in all frames. I showed you we need a linear transformation, that's to preserve homogeneity. I showed you what is the condition for which we have our Lorentz transformation, which is allowing us to force this condition. The scalar product is conserved under Lorentz transformation. And I told you that these two conditions are equivalent. The Minkowski metric is invariant with respect to Lorentz transformation. Here I briefly showed you why. Then we try to re-express the Lorentz transformation in terms of rotations. We're trying to interpret it in terms of rotations. And for that, I started with a three-dimensional rotation, so just the axis rotation in a three-dimensional space, in this case a two-dimensional space, and you have seen the relationship between cosinus and sinus. We try to do something similar for the Lorentz transformations, and we realized that we can do it if we are using hyperbolic functions. Okay? Hyperbolic functions that lead us to find out the Lorentz transformation looking like that. Okay, this is a property which is more than just playing with numbers. Well, I also showed you how this gives you the invariance of the four intervals. Here in 3D length, if I have a stick like this and I rotate the axis, the stick is the stick, and the same happens for the Lorentz transformation. I have this stick, and I'm changing the axis around it, but the stick is the stick. Okay? Good. Here is a little bit of playing like numbers, but if you are good in group theory, you could just notice that my Lorentz transformation are matrix 4x4, which respect the scalar product, they are a special orthogonal group. Done. If you're a mathematician, you already know everything. Because this sort of groups has properties that have been very well studied in mathematics. And if you ask a mathematician how this transformation looks like, it would tell you it looks like that. And in the exercise for this week, you will play a little bit with that. Okay? There is a little bit of little exercise in which you will find out that by looking at the properties of the Lorentz group, you find out that naturally. So this is more, I stress it again, this is more than just this property of sinus hyperbolicus and cosinus hyperbolicus. It's rooted in the very nature of the Lorentz transformation because they belong to the Lorentz group. They belong to this sort of groups having that property. Okay? Good. So, we can have a break here. We can